Penguin Random House Audio presents The Selected Letters of Ralph Ellison, edited by John F. Callahan and Mark C. Connor, read for you by Dominic Hoffman, with introductory essays written and read by John F. Callahan.
This book is dedicated to the living memory of Ralph Ellison. General Introduction. Ralph Ellison's life comes close to spanning the 20th century, though as the years go by, he casts a glance back to the Civil War and Reconstruction of the 19th century, and ahead to the fast-approaching digital age of the 21st. Born in 1913, about 5.5 years after Oklahoma was admitted to the Union, he lost his father, a protective companion, at the age of 3. Raised by his mother Ida with rigorous love, Ellison grew up in the mostly nurturing, close black community of the vibrant Deep Deuce section of Oklahoma City during the Jim Crow era. His story is an African-American variation of the American dream. Long after leaving Oklahoma City, this young man from the provinces, who became a sophisticated man of the world, remembers, "When I lay on a pallet in the moon-drenched kitchen door and listened and dreamed of the time when I would leave and see the world." Letter to Albert Murray, July 24, 1953. Written over 6 decades, Ellison's letters range from boyhood notes to his mother to detailed exchanges and sometimes trenchant sparring matches over ideas with some of the most distinguished figures of American intellectual and literary life: Richard Wright, Kenneth Burke, Stanley Edgar Hyman, Albert Murray, Saul Bellow, Romare Bearden, Robert Penn Warren, Richard Wilbur, Harold Bloom, Hugh Kenner. Equally important, and perhaps sometimes more so, for what they reveal about his private self and boyhood experience, are letters to old friends and relations from Oklahoma City, that frontier dream world of his childhood, to which Ellison returned with increasing frequency. Virgil Branham, Jimmy Stewart, Camille and Mamie Roan, Charles Eddie Tucker, Hester Holloway, HBO Hooley Davis. Perhaps sensing that he might not live to write a formal autobiography, in the last years of his life, Ellison wrote more and more letters that record memories of the people, places, and events of his early years in Oklahoma, and what that experience continued to mean in his life and work. Between March 1933 and June 1993, Ellison wrote letters to an expanding and expansive company of individuals. Even in the parochial Dear Mama letters he writes from Tuskegee, we see glimmers of the defiant, lyrical mind whose observations discern fluid changes in American life, society, and personality over the next 60 years. In fact, personality fascinated Ellison so completely that he dared assume the stance of bystander as well as participant, a dual perspective that infuses some of the letters with a feel of both biography and autobiography. Consider 2 letters, each from the rich trove of the 1950s, that stake out Ellison's quest as a person, citizen, and writer. After hearing a radio bulletin announced the 1954 Brown versus Board of Education decision, Ellison is wet-eyed as he reflects on what is ahead now that integration is the law of the land. "Well, so now the judges have found, and Negroes must be individuals." He ends this remarkable letter, "Anyway, here's to integration, the only integration that counts, that of the personality." a profound toast, hailing individual personal integration. Letter to Mortiza Sprague, May 19, 1954. For Ellison, the Supreme Court's ruling goes hand in hand with the challenge faced by each citizen, each person, to create an integrated self. An arduous task that decade by decade threads its way through his letters. In another letter, written not long after publication of Invisible Man, he regrets that he has lost the delight of corresponding, a harrowing condition. Since there was a time when I was more myself when writing a letter than at any other time. Letter to Richard Wright, January 21st, 1953. Rather than accept loss of delight as a chronic affliction, Ellison gives his correspondence an even more central place in his thinking, feeling, and writing life than was the case in the lead-up to and immediate aftermath of Invisible Man. Considered as a whole, Ellison's letters tell his story on several levels. Biographically, the correspondence tells of his metamorphosis from an impressionable, ambitious outsider into an articulate, accomplished denizen of Harlem, who, while making a mark in New York, nevertheless sustains fierce allegiance to his Oklahoma roots. Artistically, the letters follow his changes from a down-and-out, former aspiring symphonic composer into a writer, then a first-rate contemporary novelist, and finally, a man of letters whose embrace of American complexity leads to a defiant patriotism bred of his need to affirm while resisting. Letter to John Callahan, August 12, 1983. Personally, he wrote Time on November 27, 1958, more than a year after his return to the United States from Rome, to correct its mischaracterization of him as a Negro writer in exile. I am too vindictively American, too full of hate for the hateful aspects of this country, and too possessed by the things I love here to be too long away. Undoubtedly read by millions of Americans, his letter expresses the double delight of someone able to both master and express the only integration that counts, that of the personality. The letters of Ralph Ellison testify to the fluidity and change he sees in American life and society, as well as in himself and his relationships. Perhaps the first things to strike a reader coming for the first time to Ellison's correspondence are its remarkable longevity and the fascinating variety of people he wrote to over those 60 years in the intimate form of the letter. Decade by decade, year by year, Ellison unfolds his lifelong ambition and anxiety, confidence and uncertainty, anger and serenity, and most of all, perhaps, a quality of intensity that became vivid in his painterly observations of the natural and social terrain around him during his daily comings and goings. 3 weeks after his 20th birthday, Ellison writes the first letter in this volume to his mother from the state training school for Negro boys in Boley, an all-black town founded before Oklahoma became a state. A fetching self-deprecation presages the humor peppered through the letters. I'm Mr. Ellison out here, and I forget to answer sometimes. The 1930s produce a series of letters, many deeply personal, that mark young Ellison's growth from a dependent young man to a fiercely independent writer-to-be. From June 1933 to May 1936, his letters are written by hand at Tuskegee Institute in rural Alabama. Almost all are to his mother, Ida. A few others are to his younger brother, Herbert, and his stepfather, John Bell. And an ambiguous one is to Vivian Stevenson.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.